image itself is not well suited for that. It's very well suited for segmentation, definitely, because you can really clearly see the difference between blood and tissue. So that's why I say it's complementary, definitely. Okay. Okay, so I was saying, after this Bart interruption, that Bart just said that he is very curious to see the presentation, etc. So hello, Bart, and sorry for all that stuff. we are not living in a wonderful world. This is nice because then there's a lot of work to do for us. So this is very nice for that. But unfortunately, strain is not so well used in clinical practice because the measurements are not reproducible enough, clearly. And so there is a strong need to make the method fully automatic, not semi, but fully automatic, to produce first reproducible measurements and crossing fingers that those reproducible measurements are quite accurate, of course. So this is the key right now, and I do think that there's still a lot of work to do on that aspect to make strain measurement very efficient and interesting for clinical practice. In ultrasound, if you ask cardiologists, only global longitudinal strain, meaning the strain computed over the full myocardium and not only locally, as I just said, is used in clinical practice because this is the most reproducible measurement that we can do. But still, there's a strong need manifested by the cardiologists to improve those measurements if they really want to use those measurements. And so only global longitudinal strain is used, and regional strain, which has a strong power to detect early disease, are not used, as I said, despite clinical interest. So, everything to say that there is strong needs also to do solid quantitative validation of the current state-of-the-art method to estimate strain. And this is really the key aspect when we discussed with Mathieu 4 or 5 years ago, to be able to answer to this question. So to answer to this question, we enter really in the heart of this topic, which is the validation of cardiac strain quantification. How to do that? So there exist different methods, okay? Principally, there are 4 methods, so manual tracking, physical phantom, animal experiments, and realistic synthetic images. Starting from manual tracking, the positive stuff is that this is straightforward. Straightforward meaning that you pay someone, because this is very painful, to track manually a point over the cardiac cycle, do it for many points, and so you have the reference, and so you can compare with this reference. So this is quite easy to do. It takes a lot of time and a lot of coffee, and you start to have some trouble with your hand, but this is feasible. Mathieu can tell you that because he did a challenge on that a few years ago, and then he said, I stop it, never I will do it again. But this is feasible, you can.
Yeah. In the paper, there are 2 observers, and I'm the one introducing all the variability.
Yeah. And this is the point I mentioned there. Even if it's quite easy, of course, it introduces inter and intra-expert variability that we have to take into account. So that means not only one person has to do that, but if you really want to be clean, you have to ask several persons. One person doing it twice or more, and other person doing that. So you will then measure the inter-intra-variability, and you will compare your result to this inter-intra-variability. This is the cleanest way to do. Hello. But there are other ways to do. So there are physical phantom, and this is a nice introduction, because then on Wednesday, you will have the presentation of Hélène and Patricia on the use of physical phantom to do validation. You have also animal experiments, which allow to have a direct measure of strain. I do not enter in details, but you will have presentation of Jan on that Wednesday. So the Phantom is on Tuesday. Sorry. Unfortunately, Patrick is not able to be here, so only Jan will discuss about that. And you have the use of realistic synthetic images, which allow to have a dense strain ground truth. And I'm doing the presentation right now on that, and Nicolas will discuss about this also just after. So I take some time to this. I haven't speak yet about realistic synthetic images, but I found it was a very nice introduction for the different talk that you will have during this winter school. I really think that now you have a very nice picture of what's going on and why we really need to do validation on the case of strain, but of course this is also the case for all the measurement that you can do in medical imaging. And so this is my introduction. Now I enter in details in realistic synthetic images. Mathieu, just cut me when the time is too long. Of course, there's no problem. So the motivation is that. Typically, 4 years ago, when I meet Mathieu, I had this picture in mind. And it took us 4 years to do it. We managed to do it, so I'm quite happy to show you that. My idea was to say, okay, well, my ideas, I mean, many people have the same idea, of course. The idea is to say, okay, it would be so great if we could, from a numerical phantom, okay, represented here, be able to generate, for the same numerical phantom, different realistic sequences. So ultrasound, CineMR, and TAG-MR, the most well-known used in cardiac imaging. And if we are able to do that, well, the key point will be the realistic properties of those simulated sequences. Then it will be nice to do many different studies focusing on one particular modality, but also trying to investigate what can be measured. So this is a way to answer to you, Sherif, also. What are we really able to measure and how accurate, depending on the modality, starting from the same reference, the same numerical phantom, okay? And so this is the end of the thesis of Etienne that Mathieu... So
as a comment, the phantom is the simulation that comes from INRIA. So
yeah, of course, but I will discuss about that after, of course. It was just an introduction. But this is what our PhD just presented a few months ago. Okay, so you can clearly see it's ongoing work. And so this is, all those pictures are simulation. So how to do that? As I said, even if it's a multimodality framework that we have proposed, because of time, I will concentrate on ultrasound. As I said, I have some slide on MR and we can discuss about that, but I really go in details with the ultrasound modality. So there will be 3 points. The physical principle, which is needed to better understand how to simulate realistic ultrasound images. The use of physical simulator, I will say why, and the proposed pipeline that we have done. So starting from physical principle, for those who had the chance to be there last year at the winter school, I did a 1 hour talk on the physics, the principle of ultrasound physics. So don't hesitate to go on YouTube, and if you are interested, to have a full presentation on that. Very briefly, the principle of ultrasound is very simple. So this is the probe, okay? This is the piezoelectric element, which are elements that are very great because if you stimulate them by an electrical signal, they will vibrate and create an acoustic pressure. But also, if the piezoelectric element receive an acoustic wave, it will convert it to an electrical signal. So it works on the two sides, okay? So typically we will activate, okay, thanks to an electrical signal, some of the piezoelectric element that will vibrate at the same times, and depending on the delay we will apply in terms of electrical signal for each piezoelectric element, we will be able to generate different kind of wave beam. And typically here, we have done a focus, what we name a focus beam, meaning that it focuses at one particular point in the medium. So this is the emission, and by the time that we emit, then the probe enter in a reception mode. Okay, so all the scatterers present in the medium that has been illuminated by the wave will emit back some backscattered echo that will be received by the same element from the probe. We will do what we name beamforming, meaning that we will get back all these signals, and from those signals we will be able to reconstruct a few lines in this case. Okay, and this step is named beamforming. And we repeat, in the case of focus beam, we repeat this process to be able to reconstruct the full image. That's the basic of ultrasound, nothing more. So quite easy. And typically by doing so, in focus beam, we are able to have between 50 to 100 images per second. So this is a real-time images, and this is what makes it so interesting. Mathieu just spoke a little bit about ultra-fast imaging. I will not speak about that too much. Just the idea is to multiply, keep in mind that we are able to multiply by 10 the number of images per second using those techniques. But of course, then the image quality is reduced, so then it's a compromise. Okay, just keep this in mind. So this is the part of emission, reception, and ultrasound image formation. But for the particularity of ultrasound synthetic simulation, we have to focus on the medium, on the interaction between the wave and the medium. So when the wave propagates, it creates what I name here expansion and contraction of the insonified medium, okay, which will make the creation of interaction between the medium and the wave in many different ways. And the most important are the reflection, the refraction, the scattering, and the attenuation. In terms of reflection, there are two kinds. There are the specular reflection. The specular reflection happens when the ultrasound wave will reach a part of the medium with different impedance. Okay. And if the dimension of this interface is bigger than the wavelength of the ultrasound, okay, so this is what we name large reflector, it will, a part of the wave will be transmitted, but also a part of the wave will be reflected to the ultrasound probe, okay? So this happens for large reflector, but also for smooth surface like bone. There's also what we name the diffuse reflection, which happens when you do not have a smooth interface, but a rough interface. So for example, this is the case for smooth tissue that will backpropagate a wave, but everywhere in the medium, not only in the opposite direction of the ultrasound wave. Typically, if we take a nice picture of an ultrasound, what we name specular reflection will happen, for example, here because there is the spine, and so it corresponds to, it has the properties that I mentioned to create a specular wave. But also here for the skull, okay, and in the brain, this is what I name soft tissue, you will have this diffuse reflection. That happens. There's also something very important to consider, which is scattering. So scattering happens when the structure that will be reached by the ultrasound wave has dimension which is definitely smaller than the wavelength. So this is an illustration. So this is, for example, the case for blood, but as you will see for over part of the heart. So typically, this is a simulation where we put it only one scatterer. This is a plan wave, an ultrasound plan wave that is transmitted, and you see that by the time that the plan wave reaches the scatterers will create what we name a circular wave that will propagate the wave everywhere in the medium. Okay? Now if we do, we repeat this process, but using more scatterers, well, the contrast is not so nice, but you can see, of course, it's obvious, each circular wave will start to interact, so this is the case there, between themselves, okay? If you go a little bit further and put many, many scatterers, then this is what happens. And you see that all this interaction that comes from randomly distributed scatterers will create what we name speckle. Okay, speckle, okay, is due to the presence of many scatterers in the medium that are randomly distributed, that will interact, and that will create those kind of motifs. Okay? So this is here an illustration using plan wave, and this is here an illustration using a focus beam. The same phenomena happen. Okay? So speckle is something important to understand because this is the key for tracking in ultrasound and so for strain estimation. Because you see that those speckle, those motifs, create some kind of texture, and so we will want to follow the texture during the tracking in ultrasound. Because we make the hypothesis that then we will be able to follow the scatters that make happen this speckle, and so we will be able to follow the tissue, in fact, that is inside. So you can see the speckle as a signature, as a local signature of the tissue in ultrasound. Yes?
For current ultrasound, standard routine ultrasound imaging is focus wave.
Yes.
Right? Okay.
Yes.
So in the new generation, like high frame rate, is plane wave?
It's plane wave or diverging waves.
So we do expect much more speckle for these ones? Given this?
No, because the phenomenon is the same. If I go back here, okay, all the scatterers that are present in the insonified medium will interact between them and create speckle along this direction, speckle information along this direction. When you do ultra-fast imaging, the same phenomenon happens, but for the full medium. So when you say you will have more speckle, you mean that you will have speckle everywhere in the image because, yeah, but this is also the case in focus because you repeat this process on the full medium. Okay, so scattering happens in soft tissue, and so soft tissue could be seen as a set of scattering points. And these points is very important, because typically what does it mean? It means that for the myocardium region, typically here, you can see that there are effectively speckle inside the myocardium, even if it's quite complicated in the myocardium. Okay, you have fibers, you have a main orientation of fibers around the heart, etc. You can simulate that as a set of scatterers, as point scatterers. Okay, it will be equivalent. Even if it's not the reality, it will be equivalent somehow at a certain stage, let's say. And this is for simulation what we use, in fact. So ultrasound image can be seen mainly as interference, as an interference in imaging technique because of this, and there is an intrinsic speckle property that is inherent to this modality, which is very nice for tracking, in fact. Yes?
Is it possible, to increase the degree of scattering, to increase the speckles if you change the wavelength?
Okay, you're totally right. I think I will say it in my presentation. The key aspect for speckle is the number of scatterers inside what we name the resolution cell. Okay, resolution cell, you can see it as a square whose dimension correspond to the point spread function of your system. Okay, so typically it's around 0.5 millimeters cube or square, if you work in 3D or 2D. And so to have speckle, you have to have many scatterers per resolution cell. And the size of the resolution cell is linked to the wavelengths, to the frequency of your probe. So if you change the frequency, you will change the size of the resolution cell, and so you will change the number of scatterers you will take into account when you will reconstruct your image, so it will have an impact on the speckle. The speckle will be different if you change the frequency. It's quite easy. For example, if you want to go far in the body, you will use a lower frequency, let's say. So typically it's 2.5 megahertz. So the size of the speckle will increase because the size of the resolution cell will increase. But typically if you want to do, if you want to do carotid, for example, acquisition, you will use a high frequency probe, typically well between 9 and 12 megahertz, I would say. And so you will see that the size of the speckle is thinner, is very, very small, and it has an impact because of that. It's very easy to explain because of the size of resolution cells, which is linked to the probe. Good question. Okay. I don't know about the time, but I continue. Everything is nice. Okay. Let's move to the physical simulator. So we have made the choice in ultrasound to use physical simulator for the reason I will explain just after. But let's say first that there exists in the literature, if you go on Google and you type ultrasound physical simulator, you will see that there exist already many different simulators. Among the most famous one, there is Phil2 and a fast version which is named COAL. There is so this is a simulator based on linear modeling of the propagation of the wave. There is a simulator named CréaNuit that is a non-linear simulator of the acoustic wave. There is a new one that you will use during the hands-on session, which is named Simus, which is more or less a Phil2 simulator, and others. Okay. What is very interesting, so they are all, okay, I have to stop doing that. What is very interesting with these physical simulators is that they are all working the same, meaning that to generate an image, you have two things to do. First, you have to characterize the probe that you are using to control the emitted field, and you have to define a medium that will be insonified by the wave through point scatterers, and only point scatterers for the reason I just explained to you. Okay. As I said, during the hands-on session, you will use Simus. So basically, to summarize, if you want to be able to simulate a nice-looking imaging, okay, using a physical simulator, you need two things. You need to design the probe settings, and you have to define the medium. Concerning the probe side, well, it's quite easy, I would say. You just need to know, because the physical simulator are very well suited for that. You just need to know a typical characteristic of ultrasound probe to mimic what happens in reality. So for example, for a cardiac probe, typically the number of elements used, by element I mean the piezoelectric element is 64. The pitch, which is the distance between two elements, is 0.28 millimeters, the 8 is 13 millimeters. Elevation focus, I will not speak about that. The central frequency, I just spoke with central frequency, is 2.7 megahertz because you want to go up to 15 millimeters in the body. And the bandwidth is 60% around the center of frequency. So this is typically the information you need to enter. And thanks to that, you will be able to simulate a realistic wave. And this is the first part of my hands-on session on simulation, is really on this emission. So this is quite easy to control. All the simulators are nice. This is not the hardest part of to design realistic simulation. The hardest part is really this one, the design of the medium, okay, the numerical medium that will be able to reconstruct nice-looking imaging. And so to do that, since this is scattering approach, you will need to fix those parameters. N is the total number, okay, it's here, of the scatterers that you will put inside the volume that you want to reconstruct. X, Y, Y, and Z, Y are the positioning of all those scatterers. And A is the amplitude. By amplitude, I mean the backscatter amplitude that one scatterer will provide back to the probe. Okay, so you have to define that. If you are able to define something realistic, then the game is done. You will be able to simulate realistic images. Okay. You will tell me, yeah, but this is only scattering approach. We know that we can have specular reflection, as I just say. Yeah, but in this way of doing simulation, it's quite easy to simulate specular reflection. You just need to put amplitude with strong value coherently, for example, along a bone, to then generate bone property in the images. And, well, I just speak about that. To have scattering property, the only things to do is to have many scatterer per resolution cell, as I just said. So this is all the game now is there. How to do that, then to be able to have realistic simulation. So the big question is how to choose N, X, Y, Z, and A, to have a passing through the physical simulator to have a realistic ultrasound image. So now the final part of my talk will concentrate on that. No question? Okay. So first, first things to do is to select the total number of scatterers. Okay, so this is, as I said, constrained by the settings of the probe that you use, and typically the frequency on which you will work on. So typically, in cardiac imaging, you will work with 2.67 or 3 megahertz, which we can estimate that, which will produce resolution cells of about 0.5 millimeter cube or square. And based on that, if you know the resolution cell and you know the dimension of the space that you want to fill in, then it's quite easy to, if you say I want to have, for example, 20 scatterer per resolution cell, randomly distributed, then you know how to do, well, N, you know the total number of scatterers you will put everywhere in the space, okay? The choice that we do, I will say it after, but we randomly distributed them to have speckle nature, okay? So typically, how many scatterer per resolution cell do we have to put? You can find different numbers in the literature, there's no convention, but let's say that if you have more than 20 scatterer per resolution cell, we can prove, we can measure it, that then we will have a particular speckle which is named as fully developed speckle, which is the one that we find usually in soft tissue. Okay? So during the hands-on session, you will be able to play with that, but you will see that, 20 is a little bit high, but we can simulate with 20 scatter per resolution cell, and you will obtain speckle for sure. So we have N. We know the total number of scatterers that we will uniformly distributed over the image dimension to fill the image space. Now, what about A, the amplitude? So, as I said, we have a space that we fill with scatterers, randomly distributed. We know the number of scatterers. Now, we want to know which amplitude we will put on each scatterers. To do that, well, this is an idea we have with Martino in 2011 on a conference. So it's quite an old idea. Well, I mean, many people has this idea before, I guess, but never really formalize it. But the idea is to say, okay, we want to have realistic images, so we will get use of a real image to estimate this value of amplitude. Okay, so we start with a real image, and the idea is to say, are we able to reproduce it thanks to something we will measure on this image? To reproduce more or less the same exact images. So how to do that? Well, we work on equation, okay, based on the image formation in ultrasound. And what we have proposed is this simple equation that say, well, if you want, for example, to, in the image you will reconstruct, you will simulate, if you want to have the same intensity for this particular region that will be here, okay, then if you measure the intensity of the BMOD images on the template, which is high here, you only have to apply this equation to estimate the amplitude that you have to put in the physical simulator to have back the same intensity more or less in your simulation. Okay, so you see it's quite easy. But if you do that, so typically you have many, for example, I don't know here, it's millions of scatterers. For each scatterer, okay, you can estimate the position in the real image, measure the intensity by doing interpolation, because this is continuous coordinate and this is a pixel-wise coordinate. So by interpolation, you measure the corresponding intensity, You apply this simple equation, you have a rough, you have the estimation of A you have to apply to these scatterers. And you do that for all the scatterers. If you do that, you will see during the hands-on session, then you are able to reconstruct a nice looking imaging. Okay.
Some question I get.
Yes.
That's assuming a distribution that's uniform in the space. Do you think it's really the case? Or?
Again, so this is exactly what I said. There is the reality. Okay, so for example, fibers, orientation, etc. And there is the simulation part. And the simulation part says that if you have enough scatterers randomly distributed, you will be able to reconstruct a speckle. So it will definitely not be the same speckle, but you will have speckle. But in terms of relative intensity, if you apply this amplitude, you will have relative intensity that are close to the image. So definitely, this is what we name a synthetic images. It's not pure physical modeling of the medium. Definitely not. This is not what we want to do here. We want to generate images from a physical simulator. We will see why after. Sorry for that. But that first looks quite close to the template image. But this is really not the same. We haven't tried to modelize because, to my opinion, it's too difficult. We haven't tried to modelize the myocardium on its own and try to reproduce as close as possible the medium, the numerical medium that will create the same images. This is definitely not what we have done. Yes?
Well, in physics, there are ways actually to, there are tables, for example, who model, there are people who model the scattering like with spherical wave. Actually, it's just a question of spherical scattering by, I mean, they're based, a lot of articles are based on a spherical model, a small particle, a spherical model, and with a difference in how do you say, reflection index inside and outside, and they calculate actually this kind of thing. It's done mainly for blood cells because it's a bit easier.
Yeah.
But because I mean, well, I mean, very approximately, of course, a sphere. But you can actually do this.
You're already in approximation.
There's already an approximation, but and also there are people who made physical measurements on cell of different kind of cells. I mean, there are a lot of artists. Did you try to use this information and compare with your own?
No, because really, I mean, before we do those simulation, if you have a look on the state of the art method, the realistic property of those methods was a nightmare. It was really bad, and so here, our idea was to say, okay, let's try first to do things simple and see how far we can go with those methods. I totally agree with you, and I really insist before that. We haven't tried to go too much in details on the simulation of the medium itself. It can be done. Well, you know, there are a lot of work to do it. But really, we try to avoid it.
There really work actually with tables about the intensity.
Yeah, but yeah, of course. But what you're speaking about, this is spherical stuff. And typically, in myocardium, you cannot modelize the tissue using only spherical.
There are also in the literature. There is also they measure the attenuation. Actually, exactly the kind of step that you're doing and linking it actually to the scatter intensity. They give you the attenuation in different media, and it's done in tables. And the article is rather old. Perhaps 70s and 80s.
Yes. I'm aware about that. But again, this is really not the way we want it to do. And we haven't taken the time to compare with this because I guess it's very difficult with those methods to simulate, to integrate all the complex information of the myocardium. Again, I'm speaking of the full image and not only blood here. And by doing this, it's just intrinsic and you will reproduce all the artifacts that are in the image without the need of complex modeling. And this is the key aspect of this way of doing. Again, there are limitations, of course. I'm not saying this is perfect. There are, as I said, there's a lot of things also to do, again. But this is really the way where we want it to go here. Yes?
By just looking at this equation, it depends on explicitly on the maximum intensity of your image.
Yep.
And I'm a little bit worried about that because if you take some industrial scanner and you can actually change that IMAX very easily from different setting of a TGC, all those settings you can easily tweak and have different different values of those.
Of course.
And I try to imagine that probably you are looking at some attenuation factors here between the IMAX and I, and to try to figure out some estimation of that attenuation factor and to guide your intensity. So how, in real life, how accurate or how robust that you would just take the IMAX at the reference of this for this amplitude estimation. Yeah.
So again, this is synthetic images that we are doing, and I insist on that. Typically, since we start with real images, which I named template images, we know that all constructors do post-processing, okay, to try to improve the image quality because it's very important. And so by the time that we consider that, we should accept that the picture that we use is already post-processed, and so attenuation or all that stuff disappear, okay, because it's post-processed. We only try to, in a synthetic way, reproduce as close as possible, okay, the same kind of images, okay, without the need, again, I insist on that, of going too much in details on all the modelization that needs to be done, attenuation, orientation, etc. Because, well, it's post-processed after all, okay? So here we just want, so the way that we do, incorporate all that stuff intrinsically without the needs of modeling, okay? Because it's really not the goal here, as I will say. The goal here is to have an image which is visually close to a real one, but with a ground truth for the motion of the myocardium. Okay? So that's why we go on that way. In terms of success, it was more guarantee to reach something nice, I would say, in few years.
I have a small question. Does the impact of the when you go from the real image to the scattering map,
yes,
you said that you need an interpolation.
Yeah.
Does the method that you use for this interpolation has a great impact or not really?
No, not really. Why? It's quite simple. It's because we have so much scatterer spare resolution cells. The goal, it will have a small impact on the kind of speckle you will get, but then the speckle you will track over time, so you don't really care if the speckle change a little bit because you do linear or spline interpolation. By the time you have your speckle, whatever the method, then you will track it over time, and this is the key aspect. And this speckle texture will change every time because we do random scattering distribution. So it has really a low or zero impact. Okay, let's move on. Every time I'm scared with the time. You are the one who take care of the time. But there's a lot of questions, it's nice. Là, je suis à la moitié. Si on fait l'IRM, on oublie l'IRM, je vais jusqu'à 45 slides. Voilà. It's up to you. Just let me know. Now let's continue.
Let's continue like 5-10 minutes and then
Okay. And so, as I said, by doing so, I try to convince you then, because you asked very nice question, which, I mean, the question you just asked, the both of you, is exactly the question I had 4 years ago. And we have to make a choice. Either we go very far and deep on the physical modelization of tissue, etc., or we do something simple because we are only focusing on what we name synthetic images, and this is where we really want it to go. And just keep in mind that this is synthetic images. And so, for example, so templates, by template I mean real image. If we use a real image using different scanners, using the method I just described, this is the image that we simulated by doing so. Okay? Only for one image. So you can see that, of course, for example, here it's a very nice illustration. There has been post-processing, for sure, and so you see that the speckle nature tends to disappear in this image just because of post-processing, for sure. And because we haven't applied this post-processing, we still have speckle nature in our simulation. It's intrinsic to our simulation, okay? So it will not be exactly the same, for sure, but you see that you are not so far using those equations, and this is the key. Maybe the we can stop here, and then I speak about the proposed pipeline. Otherwise, we will cut at the middle of my explanation. This is the final step of my presentation.
Let's stop here then, and then we'll continue either after the break or on Wednesday. We can discuss what's best.
It's up to you.
I think coffee is there, so if you feel a bit cold, that's not your chance to warm up. So thanks a lot for being very proactive and asking many questions. And let's thank you.